Yeah, we're almost done with the book of Galatians. We've been doing a verse-by-verse study of the book of Galatians, and we're at the last section now. We're at Galatians chapter 6, verses 11 through 18, and as we saw that the book of Galatians is about justification by faith, and Apostle Paul, when he started the book of Galatians, he was actually admonishing these Galatian believers who went after a false gospel so quickly. And at this point, as he closes this section, he actually circles back and talks about the essence of salvation, and that's the cross of Christ. And so I would like to read for us our section of the scripture, Galatians 6, 11 through 18, which says, "See that what large letters I have written to you with my own hand, as many as desire to make a good showing in the flesh, these would compel you to circumcise, only that they may not suffer persecution for the cross of Christ. For not even those who are circumcised keep the law, but they desire to have you circumcised, that they should boast in your flesh. But God forbid that I should boast except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. For in Christ Jesus neither circumcision nor uncircumcision avails anything, but a new creation. And as many as walk according to this rule, peace and mercy be upon them and upon Israel of God. From now on, let no one trouble me, for I bear in my body the marks of the Lord Jesus. Brethren, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit. Amen." Lord Jesus, we thank you for who you are. We thank you, Lord, for this opportunity to come before your holy presence. And Lord, we pray that you would minister to us, because we are sitting under your teaching, under your word. Let your spirit empower us today. Help us to understand the value of the cross that you ultimately bore, and no one else but you could qualify to accomplish all that you did on the cross. So Lord, help us to have a greater sense of what you've done on the cross today. And Lord, we again just come before you and all of you, and we thank you, Lord, for your sacrificial love and for the death that you bore on the cross for our sins. So in your name, Lord Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. So Apostle Paul concludes his book of Galatians, this epistle to the letter to the Galatian believers. And he writes and says in verse 11, "See what large letters I have written to you." I just want to make a quick comment here. But, you know, that says that Paul wrote this letter. Of course, we know that Paul wrote it. Then why does he put this particular statement in here? "See what large letters I have written." Didn't Paul write Galatians? Yes, he did. But why does he say this? Well, because Paul had an amanuensis. That's a fancy word for secretary. Just like, you know, CEOs have secretaries, they dictate to the secretaries what they want to say, what they want to convey, and the secretaries write them up, and then the CEOs just sign, right? So it's the content of the CEO, not the secretary. So Paul had amanuensis or a secretary to help him write, and that's why he states this. And of course, the Bible talks about, gives us a little bit of clue that he had some poor vision, and so that's why he may have written so largely. So I just wanted to address that real quickly. It seems to come out of nowhere, but I do want to let you know that Paul did write the book of Galatians. And now, the content that we want to focus on is the content of the cross of Christ. Paul, again, addresses the fact that the flesh is not what saves people. The Galatian believers, remember, that after they heard the gospel, many of them then turned away from the gospel of Christ. Christ and wanted to go back to the law and wanted to go back to the things of the law like circumcision. And Paul says, hey, circumcision, no circumcision, that's not the point. That's not where you need to focus on. The focus is the cross of Christ. And he says, again in verse 14, but God forbid that I should boast except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. For in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision nor uncircumcision avails anything but a new creation. Let me focus a little bit on the cross of Christ. Why Paul is emphasizing the cross of Christ. Not only in this epistle, but in the epistle of 1 Corinthians and other passages where Paul says, I preach Christ crucified. Why is Paul so hung up on the cross of Christ? Why is he focusing on Christ and Christ crucified? Because, you see, the cross, first of all, is something that is the clearest evidence, in some ways, the guilt of the world, the guilt of mankind. The cross of Christ, you see, is there because of man's sin. It's the climax, in some ways, of man realizing the sin because God had to punish that sin. And without the cross of Christ, you see, sin never improves. Sin always going to be sin, and the offense of God is, it is a direct offense to God, and all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. So the cross is one of the clearest evidences of the guilt of mankind. Secondly, the cross is also one of the strongest proofs of God's hatred towards sin. God hates sin. In Ezekiel, he says, the soul of the ones who sin dies. Ezekiel 18:20. And then, of course, we know Romans 6:23, for the wages of sin is death. So the cross is one of the strongest proofs of God's hatred towards sin. Scripture says in Hebrews 9:22, without shedding of blood, there is no remission, or there is no forgiveness of sin. Why? Because, why the blood? Because the book of the Old Testament says that in Leviticus, life is in the blood. And you look at any living being, whether it's humans or animals, life is in the blood, especially the humans. And without the shedding of this blood, this life, there is no forgiveness of sin. God cannot tolerate sin. And so the cross represents proof that God hates sin. Thirdly, the cross also represents God's gracious demonstration of his love for us. For whosoever believes shall not perish but have everlasting life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes shall not perish, but have everlasting life. Romans 5:8 says that God has demonstrated his own love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. So the cross is a representation of God's love, or demonstration of his love for us. And why is also Paul focusing on the cross? Because the cross is a way of victory for you and for me. Those of us who trust in Jesus Christ and the work that he has done on the cross, we can have victory in life. Because sin is offensive, and without the cross of Christ, we cannot overcome our sins. Sin has been defeated. Death has been defeated. Or death, where is thy victory? And so we have victory over sin, we have victory over death because of the work of the cross. And also victory over Satan. Many times you and I are tempted in many ways, and we succumb to those temptations, and then we fall. Without Christ, we will never have victory. But with Christ, we do have victory in Him. And so that's why Apostle Paul focuses on the cross of Christ, because of these factors about the cross that he knows. He knows that the cross of Christ is the clearest evidence of man's guilt, strongest proof of God's hatred for sin, a gracious proof of God's love for mankind, and the only way to victory. And so that's why he circles back and says, he focuses on the cross. He preaches Christ crucified. Not the law. Not being circumcised or uncircumcised. Not being sidetracked by a false gospel. And many times people are sidetracked by the false gospel. And many times people don't want to talk about sin. They want to massage sin and not call it for what it is. But Paul understands that sin is a direct offense to God. Let me put it this way. Give you a little bit of an illustration of how our relationship with God was affected, and how the cross of Christ ultimately restored that relationship which we once had, was lost and now gained. At the time when God created Adam and Eve, so you can think of God and Adam, they're facing each other. Before Adam sinned, before God, Adam and God were face to face. And you know, God always has a halo. Adam had a halo at that time. He was a saint. And so they were facing each other, walking hand in hand in the garden. And so when Adam chose to disobey God volitionally, he willfully chose to disobey God. And you know what happened? Adam chose to turn his face away from God. Sin in Adam's life chose Adam to turn away from God. And you know what? At that point, God was forced to turn his face away from Adam, because sin is a direct offense to God. The halo of God still stays, but Adam lost his halo. The wrath of God is on Adam's head now. Why? Because of the sin that he created. And so there is sin that's dividing Adam and God. That's known as the fall of man. So when that happened, you have this separation between God and man. But then there's that work on the cross, and part of that is redemption. Redemption, you know, is to purchase back, to buy back. And so what that does is this: that sin that separates man and God, one of the byproducts of redemption is that sin is removed. Now, the wrath of God is still on man. Of course, God is still holy. They're still facing opposite way. However, because of redemption, sin is now removed. And then propitiation takes place. So you know what propitiation? Propitiation is to appease God. And some translations use atonement for propitiation. So you have God and man looking the other way. However, because of the work of cross, propitiation allows God to turn back toward man. Redemption removes sin. Propitiation turns God back towards man. God's halo, God continues to be holy. He is always going to be holy. Man, the wrath of God is still on man, despite the fact that sin is removed and propitiation has taken place. God is turning toward man. And then there's reconciliation. The Bible talks about reconciliation as the work of the cross. And what that is, to bring people in harmony, would bring God and man into harmony. So man now is able to turn his face toward God because of reconciliation. The wrath of God is still on man. And that wrath is removed during justification. Justification is when God judicially declares man is righteous before him. And so the wrath of God is removed. So now man is facing God, and the wrath of God is removed from man. And so because of justification, that position in Christ being holy, the man now regains his halo. He's holy. And then ultimately when man dies, glorification takes place where God and man walk hand in hand, side by side. This is the work of the cross. Because of what Jesus did on the cross, all of these things apply. So you see why Apostle Paul says that he preaches Christ crucified. Why he focused so much on the cross of Christ. Because all of this is the work that Jesus completed on the cross. Redemption. Purchasing. And removing sin. And Jesus purchased it with his blood. Propitiation, to appease God. Reconciliation, to bring us back in harmony to God. Justification, to be judicially declared righteous before God. And ultimately, when we go to heaven, glorification. And that's why Paul says, verse 16, and as many as walk according to this rule, what rule? New creation, because the tail end of verse 15 says, but a new creation. Why does he use that contrast word? He's saying, yeah, for in Christ neither circumcision nor uncircumcision avails much. It's not, you know, the rite of circumcision is not the physical act or physical way of works of any kind that merits anything. It's the work of Christ. It's what Christ has done on the cross. And as a result, we are given a new creation, a new nature, as 2 Corinthians 5:17 says. Therefore, if any man is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away, behold, new things have come. And so in light of that phrase, but a new creation, then verse 16 kicks in, and as many as walk according to this rule, will rule the new creation, those who are in Christ. Have peace and mercy. We have judicial peace before God because of justification. We also have mercy. God withholding what we deserve. We deserve punishment. We deserve the wrath of God. But he withheld that. He actually exacted that wrath on Jesus Christ at the cross. And so, Paul says, hey, walk according to your new creation. Walk according to the fact that you are now children of God. And be thankful that you have peace before him and that you also have been given mercy. And so, again, Paul continually emphasizes the cross of Christ. As he says in Galatians 2:20, I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and delivered himself up for me. So in terms of application, in light of the truth about the cross, Christ, and the penalty that was exacted on Jesus Christ for you and for me, what would be our application? We need to preach Christ crucified, just like Paul. We need to put Christ at the forefront of everything. The cross of Christ is very significant. Yes, the resurrection is the validity of Christianity, but the cross of Christ is central to our faith. And that's why Paul focuses on it. So if Paul focuses on this, and Paul was given much wisdom in terms of theology, shouldn't you and I also focus on the cross of Christ? We should deny ourselves daily as Jesus instructed us, and focus on Him, and be not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. Why? For it is the power of God for salvation. And what gives that power? The cross of Christ. The work that Christ did on the cross gives salvation to those who believe, to the Jew first and also to the Gentiles. Why Jew first? Because they were given the law. They were given the gospel first. And so the cross of Christ is central to our faith. And the cross of Christ is the basis of our salvation. Yes, because of the cross, the basis of our salvation is actually the promise of God in light of the cross of Christ, in light of Christ dying for your sins and my sins. And that's why when He gives the promise, whosoever believes shall not perish but have everlasting life. What is that promise based on? It's based on the work of the cross. It's based on what Jesus did on the cross. He accomplished atonement. He accomplished redemption, propitiation, reconciliation, justification, glorification, all at the same time at the cross. And Isaiah 53, verse 5, puts it this way, but He was wounded for your transgressions and ours, for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon Him, referring to Christ. By His stripes, you are healed. By His stripes, we are healed. And so do you see why Paul focuses on the cross? So, in closing, I want to challenge each and every one of us as we focus on the work that Jesus did and what He accomplished. Just wondering how you value that work. Yes, we as believers, we're thankful that God has saved us by His grace. We know that. And we're thankful that we have been given the mercy of God, God withholding judgment. And we're thankful that, you know, the cross is a symbol of the suffering and pain that Jesus faced. But how does that translate in your life and my life, day to day? Jesus gave up His life for you and for me so that we can have life, eternal life, quality life. Now, in light of what Jesus suffered, this unconditional love that He had for you and me, and He demonstrated on the cross, greater love has no one than this, that one laid down His life for his friend. How does that translate in your life, my life, as believers, as ones who understand the value that Christ has given us because of the cross? Or do we really understand it? Our life habits, our thoughts, our actions should be an indicator, might be an indicator, of whether or not you really value the cross. Because if you and I really do, then we should be like Apostle Paul. I have been crucified with Christ, and it is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. So does Christ live in you? Yes, positionally you and I know He does, but does He manifest Himself in your day-to-day living, in your greetings, at work, at home, at church? When you're with your friends, when you're with your non-Christian friends, is Christ being manifested in your life, or is your flesh coming out at these times? So Christianity is just on Sundays, but not on Monday through Saturdays. So examine your life. Let the Holy Spirit examine you. And examine me. I want to encourage all of you, as well as myself, to know our position in Christ and to know that Christ put a high value in your life and in my life. And we should put a high value on what he has done on the cross. And so in light of that, we should live our lives reflecting our Savior. We need to be holy. We need to be pure. We need to be thinking the things that he thinks, understanding the things that he understands, values the things that he values. He values eternal life. He values every individual. Do you value your friends who are not saved? Do you value your life? I submit to you that we need to be like Paul, who preaches the cross because he understood the value of the cross and all that it meant. We now understand just a little bit of glimpse of what the cross of Christ represents. Maybe you've known this before, but I just wanted to again remind you what Christ has accomplished on the cross and how you and I should live our lives in light of what Christ accomplished. And so we should live our lives victoriously in Christ because he has already won. He's defeated sin. He's defeated death. He has defeated Satan. So why are you and I as Christians live defeated lives if we do? We don't need to. We, the Christians, should live a joyful life, a fruitful life, a productive life, a life with meaning, life with compassion, life with love, life with understanding. Because ultimately, we're going to heaven. And also, before we go there, we have a relationship with the living Savior. So this should give us a sense of peace and joy and value. So I hope the cross of Christ was an encouragement to you today. And so now, as we close in prayer, we'll go to our Lord and thank him for what he has done. And afterwards, we will have communion. Lord Jesus, we are grateful for you. We are grateful for the cross that you bore for our sins, Lord. Cursed is the one who hangs on a tree, as the Bible says. We should have been on that tree. We should have been on that cross. But even if we were, of course, we would not be able to save ourselves. You, knowing that, substituted your life for us. Lord Jesus, we are so grateful. Forgive us for not being grateful. Lord, we thank you, Lord, for your sacrificial love. We thank you that your body was bruised and broken for us, and that your blood was shed for us so that we could have a personal relationship with you and with your Father, our Father. Lord Jesus, we thank you so much. We love you. In your name we pray. Amen.